Hi, everyone. I think we can start now. Thank you and welcome. I'm Michelle Halket. I live in Vancouver, British Columbia, and I'm the publisher of Central Avenue Publishing. Today, I have my colleagues from Firebrand Technologies, MetaComet, and IPG, and we're going to delve into the return on investment that can be found when we adopt powerful publishing tools and some best practices. We're going to look at the four main aspects of return on investment, or ROI, which are time savings, cost reduction, increased sales, and risk mitigation. We hope we'll offer some real-life examples and tactical recommendations of where publishers can increase their bottom line by continually refining the publishing process. You know, the decision to invest in software and systems can be daunting, and it may often seem easier to stick with the status quo. We hope that you'll leave this one-hour presentation with a better understanding of why and how you can add further value and ease to your process with some tools that are designed specifically for this industry. Okay, so a little bit about myself. I would describe myself as a bibliophile and technophile. I love to try new things, which is what prompted me to start a digital first publishing company when not too many people knew what ebooks were. But now Central Avenue is a traditional press of fiction and poetry. We also have David Marlin, who co-founded MetaComet Systems in 2000. David has been committed to enhancing the technological capabilities of the publishing world through his work as the founding co-chairman of the BISG Digital Sales Reporting Committee and a former co-chair of the BISG Rights Committee. David has an MBA from Columbia Business School. Joshua Tallent is the Director of Sales and Education at Firebrand Technologies, where his focus is on helping publishers of all sizes learn about and find solutions to their workflow and metadata problems. Joshua's background is deeply rooted in ebook development, metadata, and other publishing technologies. He serves on the board of BISG's board of directors, and he loves digging into interesting metadata issues. Richard T. Williams is the Vice President Business Development at IPG, where he pursues new publisher business and helps clients plan and develop their lists. He's a former sales manager at IPG. He was the director of the Small Press United program from its inception in 2009, and was once an operations manager at an independent publisher. And that gives him firsthand experience on the publishing side. So with all the introductions out of the way, I'd like to hand the conversation over to David Marlin from MetaComet for an introduction to the topic of return on investment.
Great, thank you, Michelle. So what is return on investment, or ROI? So I first learned about ROI in business school as a tool to compare the value of financial investments. You're looking at where to invest your money. Do I invest in A or B? And that's how ROI has traditionally began, but it has since really gone through a conceptual evolution as a way to decide on the value of any investment. So if I pay a certain price in time and effort, what will I get in return? And it's important to look beyond the strict financial costs and returns to the more subjective costs and returns. So for example, let's look at gardening. So from a purely financial view of return on investment, the cost side is what I need to spend to purchase seed, seed beds, fertilizer, soil, et cetera. And the financial return is lots of fresh vegetables with perhaps $200 in value that I could save. And is that worth it? So it's also important, you look at it that way and perhaps it's not really worth it. But if you look at the non-monetary side, on the cost side, there's the time and energy that I put in and what I'm going to need to invest personally to get that $200 worth of vegetables. But then there's the intangible side. And there's a lot more that I should be looking at than just those cost sides. So the satisfaction, what kind of satisfaction do I get from seeing the results of my work? There's the relaxation aspect of it. So I get to escape from all the overwhelming media being pummeled at me constantly. by getting out there and just focusing on the garden. And then if I'm fortunate enough to get the kids involved, I also get some family time in there as well. So there's a lot of non-monetary aspects to ROI that we need to consider. So in some ways, we all use ROI every day to make our decisions, and we don't always realize it. We don't always use quantifiable numbers, but we use the concept. Let's look, the obvious financial aspect of it is, if I decide to pay extra for an electric car, which I actually just recently did, how much will I save in gas and in maintenance? But there's also the intangible aspect of that decision. So what will I gain in terms of feeling better about helping the environment? And of course, we also need to factor in the downsides of any investment. So if I decide to go surfing in shark-infested waters, my return on investment is the excitement and the adrenaline rush. But what is the risk that I'll need limb replacement surgery? What is the cost of that risk? So when it comes to evaluating business decision for publishers, there's really four particular components of ROI that we should be looking at. The first one is time savings. And really one question that you need to always ask yourself is, how do you value your time? And in my experience, most people tend to undervalue their time. And directly related to that is, how much time does an investment decision save you? You know, if you invest in a certain piece of software, how much time are you going to save? That time savings often directly correlates to cost savings in reduced labor costs, et cetera. And then of course, there's what we call the opportunity cost. So what am I giving up by putting my time into this manual effort as opposed to being able to do something else that might be more valuable for my business? The next element of publishing ROI that we'll be looking at today is cost reduction. So some examples of cost reduction. So if I implement a new system of some sort, a new publishing system, perhaps I can get away without hiring a new person that I might otherwise need to hire if I didn't have that system. Another example is saving on outside consultants. So in my world, in the royalty world, many of our customers use outside accountants or firms to do their royalties. So if you can bring that in-house by automating that process, then there's a cost reduction as well. You may not need to support a custom development team or individual to maintain a legacy homegrown system. Another aspect of publishing ROI that we'll be looking at today is an increase in sales. So what added revenue can I create with these freed up resources? And also, what added revenue can I create from going from a reactive state to a proactive state? So for example, when it comes to metadata, I can manage my metadata and get by, or I can leverage my metadata and increase my sales. And then the final aspect of ROI that we'll be looking at today is risk mitigation. So, you know, one interesting thing is, how do you monetize risk? How do you fit that into the value equation? So it is subjective. But you know, you can ask yourself certain questions that can help you address that. So for example, if I mess up my royalties, how much is that going to cost me in terms of my author relationship, my financial penalties, my reputational penalties? How much time am I going to have to spend dealing with that situation? What if I need to hire a PR firm to fix my reputation after making that mistake? So we're very fortunate today to have Michelle with us, who can talk directly to her experience as a publisher on her investments and the return that she experienced through those investments.
Yeah, thanks, David. Yeah, I will be sharing our experience, but I should start by telling you that Central Avenue is a press of fiction and poetry at about 15 to 18 titles per year. And that's actually a lot different than 1 or 2 years ago, when it was about a dozen titles. And part of the reason that I've been able to grow is because I've implemented some different tools, some of which we're going to talk about. So I'm the publisher. I have no full-time employees, but I regularly have freelancers and consultants, either on an ad hoc basis or on retainer. So suffice it to say, I do a lot myself. You know, the main reason I wanted to participate in this webinar is because of what I've learned along the way and being forced to analyze my returns in the four areas that David just mentioned, like figuring out what my time was worth. So I'm going to share the benefits that I realize in hopes that this is prescriptive and it helps you get to a point of implementing tools perhaps sooner than I did. Because in retrospect, I really wish I had done some of these things sooner than I actually did them. So let's start with distribution. And for that, we're going to turn the talk over to Richard.
Thank you, Michelle, and hi, everybody. So obviously, I think I'm going to start with time savings and tell you that the big savings when contracting with a distributor is that for a percentage of your overall sales revenue, you do get a staff working for you. So we have, you know, the warehouse to pick, pack, and ship, so you aren't doing it out of your basement or your garage. We have an operations staff to process orders, so you aren't typing everything yourself into a spreadsheet or a database and printing out handmade invoices. We have accounting folks to bill and collect, so you don't have to chase those payments. We have more people. We have salespeople to push your brand and product to accounts. We have marketing people to push your brand and product to tastemakers and consumers. We have publicists to push your brand and product to the media. We have tons of people. We have metadata experts to massage your categories, keywords, pricing, and basic book specs. We have title development experts to help you package and position for your market. And this one cannot be overstated. We have an executive management team with something like 5,000 collective years of experience in negotiating business and publishing books.
I have to say, just to interrupt here for a second, Richard, I love your stock photos. And according to these, book distribution people are the happiest people on earth.
It's actually sadly an indication that we haven't had the opportunity to take pictures of our entire staff since the pandemic started. So, you know, that's what I have to do. Okay, so all of this is to say that the biggest way that a distributor can help you is by allowing your program to be handled by multiple groups of experts in a variety of ways, all simultaneously. This frees up your resources to apply to other areas of publishing, such as design, editorial, and production, or if you're an author, the writing. Basically, you should be focusing on what you do best. But don't just take my word for it. I'm going to use Michelle here as an example. So Michelle, tell us how much time you saved by signing with a distributor.
Sure. So before traditional distribution, I was using Lightning Source POD. So I didn't have to manage my own warehousing or invoicing. But that said, I still had many instances of following up on orders, as well as storing a cache of, you know, marketing copies out in my garage that I'd then have to manage. I was spending time on sales. I was trying to reach and sell to book buyers. And I would say my time savings just from those few things was about 10 hours a month.
Great. Thank you for that. So now we're going to move to cost reduction. Obviously, with distribution, this one is all about the economics of scale. A distributor conglomerates your list with other lists, allowing us to become a super vendor to the industry and achieving better overall business terms. So as a case in point, I wanted to compare publisher data for a publisher similar to Central Avenue to distributor data for a publisher similar to IPG, showing the difference between the number of print titles, the number of ebooks, and the number of units shipped in a year. In this case, maybe 2021, where an uptick in ebook sales has occurred due to the ongoing impact of the pandemic. So based on these numbers, if we don't get better discounts from accounts due to the volume that we sell or better freight costs from trucking companies and couriers for the volumes that we ship, then there would be no point in our business. Even the raw number of ebooks we aggregate and provide to our trading partners allows us to accomplish financial advantages that aren't available to publishers who have to forge independent relationships and or settle for one-size-fits-all rates on self-service platforms. So these savings, which differ depending on the distributor's specific business terms, which often have to do with their size when they negotiated such terms, when compared directly might simply look like pennies here or there, but when amassed, they grant additional money that can be applied towards capital expenditures like office rental, computer equipment, or software upgrades, or even human resources. So consider just for a second how a sales manager at $75,000 annually or an administrative assistant at $40,000 would be expensive for a small business, especially when you add 20% on top of that to provide employment benefits.
Yeah. You know, Richard, I think too, like as a small business, I might not need a full-time sales manager, like you've said, but I now have access to those people and that's their full-time career. You know, I do want to say that it's hard to talk about cost reduction when we move to using traditional distribution because it is expensive. But that said, once I was able to move to using a warehouse, it meant I could also move to the much cheaper offset printing for my high volume titles. And that represented a significant savings of probably 80% on printing and freight, that then I could apply that to the cost of distribution.
Right. It's all about those economics of scale. And the size of a distributor also means that we can subsidize the enormous expense of such services as NPD BookScan or Edelweiss, granting our clients access to these services at no extra cost. But our size doesn't simply boost the economy of our service. It also allows us to have reach into areas that a small publisher may not be able to reach on their own. One of the more common vendors that smaller publishers come to us to access is Barnes & Noble. So this point is related to, and thus moves us into the conversation of increased sales. So here's the IPG story in a nutshell. 50 years ago, IPG was founded with the creation of an independent publishing company, Chicago Review Press. The advent of the chain bookstores popping up in shopping malls in the late 70s and early 80s became an obstacle because independent vendors were not invited to sell their product to these soon massive institutions. Now, I hope you guys are seeing this picture of B. Dalton and getting this wave of massive nostalgia the way that I do. But this was simply because operationally, these chains could not manage the direct business with so many different and relatively small customers. CRP could simply not get a seat at the table, so to speak, to make a sales presentation. Our founders eventually made a connection with a group of publishers who were strategically banding together to increase their station in such a market. And after an acquisition, CRP now had built a distribution arm and therefore exceeded the imposed limit on vendor size. In addition to simply acquiring the ability to make a sales presentation, a publisher also has to support a known entity in order to best market its titles. This is often because no publicist or reviewer wants to give bandwidth to a title that may be hard to get, fall out of circulation, or belong to a publisher who closes its doors before it even gets off the ground. And even if a publisher is invited to make a sales presentation and can get the marketing resources to raise awareness of its products on a national level, having creative types who write and produce books also get forced into roles as sales or business people can be utterly detrimental to the development of a good publishing line. So Michelle, back at you, what sales advantages did you see when you signed to IPG?
Yeah, this was where the rubber hit the road for us because it represented a quantum leap in sales. Almost overnight, you know, IPG found opportunities that I didn't even know existed. And in the next year, my sales tripled. And that was without new titles. That was just the backlist. But what was even better was that when it came to the front list, the titles I was publishing now had a sales team actively selling and advocating for them to the trade. You know, before it was just this wait and see situation where I'd release a title and, you know, cross my fingers that the algorithms would find it and show it to consumers. The other thing that I found was that many bookstores wouldn't even stock books that they could see were POD only. And now I no longer have that issue because it doesn't really matter how I choose to print them. All my books appear as in stock.
Yeah, that's obviously very helpful for a growing business. So let's move on to mitigation of risk. In this case, I'm going to talk about three major points. First is rising labor costs. When you sign to a distributor, you lock in at rates that do not necessarily change when other costs of living and doing business increase. When our rent increases, your rate stays the same. When Illinois minimum wage increases by $5 over a few short years, we take the hit, not our clients, who would have to adjust their businesses to afford their support staff. And as white-collar workers have gone to a work-from-home environment, companies have had to support tax and hiring laws across multiple states, and we basically eat those expenses on the behalf of our clients. Credit risk averted. So with some exceptions, such as the big national accounts, IPG takes the credit risk. A bookstore or wholesaler has much more to lose if they cannot pay a major book supplier. Of course, if a major vendor such as Barnes & Noble defaults, or in fact, Borders, which actually happened when they went out of the business in the early 2010s, IPG can't completely protect you from that loss. But for smaller vendors like an independent bookstore, you are absolutely protected. And finally, cash flow. Cash flow is impacted by distribution, but it's also somewhat protected by distribution. So a cash flow really chokes when success requires reprinting suddenly that can drain a publisher's bank account quickly. And cash flow from a distributor comes from a bigger pool of resources. What I'm showing in this model is your basic reserve structure. I'm showcasing how a staggered payment guarantee is a consistent cash flow play out in case of sales that are gradually dwindling and returns that are steadily increasing. Because the reserve is taken when sales are high, that reserve is paid back when sales are lower and the returns are higher, and it helps compensate for what would otherwise be a negative month. In this case, I'm showing how a reserve on an earlier sale can help pay out like later in the year, September in this case. Michelle.
Yeah, I realized this value really early in the pandemic when I heard through the industry grapevine that certain customers weren't able to pay their bills. But that risk wasn't passed on to me, and I got paid on schedule. My shipments continued, my cash flow was for the most part preserved. So to summarize my case when it comes to distribution, I have saved about 120 hours a year. My print costs are significantly reduced. I experienced a massive increase in sales, and my cash flow has been evened out in rough times.
Thanks, Michelle, for that summary. Your support of distribution is amazing. And to the rest of you for hearing about the return on investment of signing with a distributor. We're now going to move on to royalty management. So I'll hand the reins back to David.
Great. Thank you, Richard. So when it comes to royalty management, what's the value of investing in a royalty system and automating your royalties? So to help illustrate this, I'm going to tell you a little story. I was visiting a customer of ours in Colorado Springs, and we were having lunch at this amazing restaurant with these enormous windows overlooking the beautiful mountains of Colorado Springs. Very memorable lunch, but the most memorable part of it was this customer. It was two people, the CEO and someone who works directly with the CEO. They were explaining to me how before implementing a royalty system, they had been spending 2 months every 6 months. They did semi-annual royalties, 2 months every 6 months doing nothing but royalties. And there were multiple people involved. Royalties are time consuming. There's just no way around it. And so they were able to get that process down to 2 weeks. So now they spend less than 2 weeks every 6 months, and they only have one person instead of having a whole team doing royalties. So what is the value of that time? Clearly freeing up all those people from 2 months of effort has an enormous value. And it's directly correlated to cost reduction. There's a lot of publishers use outsourced services or consultants to help them with their royalties during these crunch times. So if you're able to avoid or eliminate that cost, obviously there's some direct time cost savings there. And another example of cost savings is we speak to a lot of publishers who tell us, if we don't automate this process, we're going to have to hire someone to help us with this. And so by automating your royalties, you can avoid oftentimes hiring that additional person to manage that process. So the next part of ROI that we're going to look at is sales and increased sales. So for that, I'll go back to this Colorado publisher. The royalty, the person who is responsible for these royalties, spending 2 months every 6 months doing them, was a very important resource to the CEO and publisher. And so what was the opportunity cost of having her spend all this time managing and doing royalties? That's 4 months every year that this key person to the CEO is now freed up to free up the CEO to go out and build the business even more. So so it directly leads to increased sales in that way by having that free time by the key executive. They can focus on growing the business. So the next part of ROI when it comes to royalty management is the risk mitigation. And this is a really big part of it. Having an automated royalty process really acts as a safety net to prevent damage. So to demonstrate this, I'll tell another real world experience that I've had. So several years ago, we had a publisher contact us. They were overwhelmed. They had a couple thousand titles. And they were overwhelmed by royalties. They just couldn't get them out the door in a timely way. And you know, we had a couple conversations with them, and then they went silent. We didn't hear from them. About a year later, we got a call from a major accounting firm who explained to us that this very same customer that we hadn't heard from had been put into receivership. So basically, these people lost their publishing business because they couldn't pay royalties, because the authors were all complaining that they weren't getting their royalties paid. So, you know, that will give you a sense of the risk. I mean, that's an extreme example. But as I mentioned in the beginning, not being able to pay your royalties does represent a lot of risk. And related to that, royalties can cause a tremendous amount of stress. I can't tell you we've had people crying on the phone with us when they've talked about the stress involved with royalties. So how do you put a value on that? So that's the risk mitigation piece of royalties. So in conclusion, you know, when it comes to deciding whether to invest in an automated royalty system, you know, look at how much you're going to save in time and in money. What are the opportunities that free time is going to bring you? What are the risks and stresses that you're going to be able to eliminate from your life? All that anxiety. It'd be really interesting, Michelle, to hear what your experience is with automating royalties.
Yeah, so previously I was using accounting software, spreadsheets, and my trusty calculator and paper and pen to create royalty statements. This would take me about, I pay quarterly, so that would take me about two full days per quarter, and I'm probably underestimating that. It's taking me a couple of, and that was, sorry, that was for 40 books that I was doing. It's now taking just a couple of hours, and I'm doing triple that, if not more. So a conservative estimate is that I'm saving 72 hours a year. Now, when it comes to cost savings and sales, that's a really difficult one to quantify, because it's just really hard to know for sure. But you know, really, when I remove that time from my workload, I could focus on tasks that did make me money, like more and better acquisitions or more effective marketing. For me, risk avoidance was the biggest reason and ROI for Central Avenue. My previous workflow, like you said, David, it caused me so much stress. You know, as my company was growing, I was adding licensing and there were more and more books. It was getting more and more complex. And I would stress for the weeks before I even had to do the job. I'd be like, oh gosh, I got to do royalties again. I was worried that I wasn't entering data correctly or that my manual calculations weren't going to stand up to scrutiny should someone ask to see my books. So now I press a couple of buttons each month and quarter, and it just sends out scores of statements automatically. So what this means is that my business is scalable, because when I add new books or authors, it doesn't increase my workload on the royalty front.
Yeah, thanks for sharing that, Michelle. So now we're going to hand it off to Joshua to discuss the ROI of investing in metadata management.
Awesome. Thank you, David. I love this presentation. I love hearing Michelle's part on this too. I think it's so important to see how this actually works in a real life environment. So I want to talk a little bit about how ROI can can help you out whenever you're moving to a professional metadata management system. But to set the context, I want to share some observations that I've had when I've been talking to publishers over the years who are struggling with their data. I usually see one of four situations or some combination of these situations. The first is the publisher that, you know, nobody knows what's going on. They don't really have a handle on their metadata. If you ask them to pull together their data, they would say, well, I need to go copy it from Amazon, right? Or they just don't have, maybe there's some documents somewhere in some Dropbox folder that maybe somebody, or an old hard drive, but they're just having all of their product data in one place would be impossible if they were trying to pull it together from scratch. The second kind of publisher I run into is one that relies exclusively on the distributor. The distributor relies, does all the service of managing their data, but they don't have anything internally for handling their own metadata to send to that distributor. So this also often means they have to log into some portal of some kind, manually submit their data. And if there's some sort of problem along the way, then it's hard for them to pull that data together. Now, I as Richard and Michelle can attest, I have nothing against distributors at all. And this is not a point at all about distribution, but it's about the metadata management on the publisher side. I strongly believe that a publisher should have control over their own internal metadata, if for no other reason than it just allows them to more easily deliver that data to their distributor. But having that internal control offers a lot of other benefits to the company as well, including the freedom to move to a better distributor, like IPG, for example, when the time comes to do that. The third kind of publisher that I run into pretty often is the I can do it all myself publisher. This is the one that usually has tasked one person with the manual metadata management internally, and even the creation of Excel files, or even in some cases Onyx files for their file their delivery. So this often isn't the result of a well thought out process or workflow. It's often just the natural result of kind of changing needs over time. A company is growing, the decisions made to bring the metadata management in-house somehow. So somebody creates a spreadsheet, or sometimes a few different spreadsheets are created with different types of pieces of data in them. And then this this becomes like a workflow spreadsheet that's used for project tracking, and then separate additional documents and spreadsheets that other things. And so over time, there's just one person who kind of naturally takes on the role of managing the data. Sometimes it's an editorial assistant or an intern who's then later pulled in full time. Sometimes even the sales manager or someone much further up the food chain. And then this one person often spends 10 or 20 hours a week just managing metadata files, just updating a master spreadsheet, getting information from different people or other documents, and then creating different separate spreadsheets and other files to send them off to their partners. Sometimes 10, 15, or even 20 of those different documents for their print books and their eBooks, and then manually loading those spreadsheets into different FTP sites. The process is constant, and it just requires half of that person's time every week, if not more.
This person's problem is really that she bought binders that are way too big for the amount of paper that she has, not to mention the length of her arms.
Yeah, it's not very efficient process there, is it? So then the fourth kind of publisher that I run into is the homegrown solution or the homebrew solution. Now, homebrew can mean a couple of different things to different people. For some of you here, especially if you're like me or from the Pacific Northwest, homebrew looks like water that's perfectly heated to 200 degrees in an antique teapot, then poured over 25 grams of hand-ground coffee, resulting in a cup of coffee that has subtle nuances of just having way too much time on your hands. And then for other people, homebrew looks like a very highly technical, often inconsistent, and occasionally rewarding process that just as often results in vinegar as it does in beer. So whatever homebrew might mean to you, there are a lot of publishers who have created homebrew metadata management systems internally. And this publisher is often a variant of or some sort of extension of the I can do it myself publisher. You know, they saw the need for some sort of solution to their metadata problems, but they decided the best way to fix it was not to put everything into spreadsheets because databases were a better solution. So they set up some sort of Airtable system or a FileMaker system, or they decided to go with some very cheap Onyx creation program. However that process was implemented, the publisher usually has been using the system for at least a few years and sometimes even decades. And they've created some sort of hodgepodge homegrown system that can create a spreadsheet or sometimes an Onyx file, but then they just manually upload to their partners. But the problem is the systems like these have limitations. You know, one of the biggest ones is the what if John gets hit by a bus problem. And another is the requirement that the publishers have to keep their custom solution up to date as industry requirements change and needs of different retail partners change, often at the expense of other company needs. And what happens is a publisher essentially becomes a software company, but without the time or the resources to really develop the best solutions to the constantly changing rigors of the metadata supply chain. All right, I've been talking a lot. So Michelle, before I go on, you used to do some of this stuff yourself. And so before you moved to a professional system, last year, I think it was, what kind of, you were in the second publisher group, is that right?
Okay, well, two things, Joshua. So first, we're going to pretend that John can't work because he won the lottery, not because he got hit by a bus. But yes, secondly, I'm pretty sure that I was actually an embarrassing mashup of all four of those things that you just described.
Yeah, and that's not uncommon either. Yeah. You know, all of these publishers have unique challenges. But in each and every case, and in your case as well, the move to a professional metadata management system offers a clear benefit over the current solution. So let's talk about the ROI. First of all, time savings. Now, for most publishers, the time that's spent on the metadata that they work on is often spent doing the wrong things because they don't have a professional solution in place for creating that data and sending it out where it needs to go. As I described the four kind of common publisher types a minute ago, you probably heard some of these time sinks, you know, having to recreate data that was lost, usually by copying and pasting it from different retailer sites, or manually entering metadata into a retailer portal or distributor portal, sending out a distributor an email for every metadata change that they want to make, and then manually tracking the status of those changes, you know, managing all the different metadata elements in different spreadsheets, managing all of your data in a master spreadsheet and doing that when really Excel wasn't intended for that, copying and adapting the spreadsheet to meet the needs of different retailers and then manually loading those spreadsheets into retailer portals and a whole lot more. It's just a time sink constantly. Implementing a modern professional metadata management system is a powerful time saver because these systems will save you time by eliminating duplicate data entry, centralizing your data into one place, and allowing you to have easier delivery of your metadata wherever it needs to go. And much of this, as David was talking about earlier, it comes down to opportunity cost. What could your metadata manager be doing or your sales manager be doing if they freed up 10 or 20 hours a week? You know, saving yourself time messing with files and doing manual data entry and copying and pasting and all this other stuff is actually very beneficial and can give you a lot more opportunity to go and pursue new things like creating better metadata, updating old product pages, or marketing your products. So Michelle, one of your goals when you moved to professional metadata management software was to save time, right?
Yeah, absolutely. But it was also to make sure that my data was as good as it could be, because I was pretty comfortable with my free things that I'd put together. But one of the things was that I was worried I was missing fields because I didn't even know that I was supposed to be filling those in. You know, as the pandemic was bearing down and sales were moving online, I wanted more control over my data. And, you know, all along, I've been trying to scale my business. And that means speaking the language of the industry, which is Onyx. It's not paper and spreadsheets. So it's been over a year. It's maybe coming up on 16, 17 months since I moved to using Eloquence On Demand. And I've definitely saved time. I would say about 120 hours a year. And that's only at a dozen new titles in the front list and about 100 in the back list. So now I can keep up to date on all of the changes I want to make. I just set them. I forget it because that Onyx feed is going out every night.
Yeah. Okay. So the next element of ROI is cost reduction. Again, it's another area where that opportunity cost comes into play. So investing in a professional metadata management tool on top of your metadata manager's salary is obviously going to increase your monthly expenses. But again, that person's freedom to focus on creating better data and increasing sales is where you're going to see a return on that investment. Now, publishers often have this idea in the back of their minds that metadata management tools aren't worth the investment. And that's why so many metadata managers just end up doing doing these processes manually because their time is seen as expendable, and the desire to save that buck kind of keeps the company from investing in automation and higher quality tools. But it's important to remember that your metadata is your company's most valuable non-people asset. I'm not saying you should go overboard on the cost. I'm just saying that your metadata management costs are not the first place to try to save a dollar. You know, your new costs and the related increase in available time are really just investments back into the business that can lead to increased sales. So let's talk about increasing sales as well. You know, multiple studies over the years, including one from BISG, have shown that there's a direct correlation between metadata quality and book sales. And as a general rule, among the best-selling titles in a given year, those titles with better metadata sell at least 50% more units than those without, and in many cases, quite a bit more units than 50%, especially for things like high-quality keywords and better book descriptions. So one of the smaller publishers that we work with at Firebrand took this process to heart, and they invested directly into their metadata management. They took advantage of our metadata delivery service and our title performance monitoring service, and they spent their time savings investing in other areas like metadata quality and improvements in their marketing program. And over the course of just 3 years, they almost tripled their revenue just from Amazon without hiring any additional staff. And that's part of this larger topic of risk mitigation as well. So let's move on to that. So reducing your risk is a key reason to take on the task of implementing a professional metadata management system and a title performance monitoring system as well. So as I mentioned earlier, many publishers put their entire workflow at risk by having just one person manage their metadata using a manual process. You know, reducing manual processes and increasing automation reduces your reliance on that person and increases your flexibility as a company. Losing a metadata manager, either from leaving the company or maybe them getting promoted or, you know, them winning the lottery, is not going to be a problem if you already have a system in place, because that automation allows you some flexibility in finding a replacement. There's also risk involved when you don't have your metadata under your own control. You risk losing out on marketing opportunities. You risk the ability to deliver your metadata to new partners when you sign up a new partner very quickly and get your books to market in those locations. And you can also mitigate risk by using title performance monitoring to watch your titles in the marketplace and catch issues before they grow unmanageable. So Michelle, can you tell us just a little bit about the ROI that you saw when you moved to a professional metadata management system?
Sure. I didn't realize how much time I was spending on that task until I had it back. So that was about 120 hours a year, like I said. And, you know, like you said, Joshua, there's no doubt that moving away from my free tools to a paid one represented a cost increase. But when I look at the fact that now I can spend my time on more value-added things, I'm fine with that small cost. And like the same thing with royalty management, if I attach an hourly value to that time that I've gotten back, my true costs have gone down for sure. Yes, my sales have increased, but it's hard to know how much of that is due to using specific software. I will tell you that over the last year and a half, I have been able to spend more brain space on making sure my data is good because I can see everything in one place and I make a point of updating it and staying on top of it. And I think that's improving my online discoverability. You know, that was just too difficult before because I had 6 spreadsheets to monitor. In terms of risk, I now know that all my data is in one place and it's backed up. I also know that any change I enter is automatically distributed that night. I don't have to remember to send something. So freeing up that headspace is pretty valuable as well. Okay, we have talked at you a lot. So I'm hoping that if I summarize Central Avenue's situation, it's going to help cement the return on investments that we've talked about till now. So a very conservative estimate is that I have saved 26 hours per month. If you're like me and you're doing a lot of this yourself, you can easily determine what that's worth by taking your revenue and dividing it by your working hours. You know, my number might be different than yours, but I think it's really important to know it. You know, if that works out to $100 an hour, then saving 26 hours a month is like saving $31,000 a year. And like I said earlier, it wasn't until I worked on this webinar that I truly realize the value of my time and why it's worth it to pay others or to buy tools for certain tasks. I've always been a huge proponent of organic growth for my company. I never put, you know, Central Avenue into any sort of debt. And so any investment I made along the way had a lot of thought put into it. And so, you know, I'm not saying these things very lightly. I've really thought a lot about any investment that I've made. I think what really struck home was that now I have more brain space to spend on more value-added tasks. So I'll give you an example from my recent history. In early 2020, it was pre-pandemic, I was noticing the use of TikTok as a way of selling and discussing books. So perhaps I had that time to notice and act on it, because a year before that, I had offloaded a good portion of my time and worry spent on managing royalties. Now, you might say, that's a stretch, Michelle. You know, maybe it is, but I really don't think so. I think we all know that the prefrontal cortex is better able to function when we're not stuck back here in our animal brains, fighting and fleeing. When we offload stressful or time-consuming tactical jobs, we have the time to be more creative and strategic. My risk exposure has been vastly decreased because I know that all the revenue coming in accounts for the correct royalty payments. And I'm fulfilling all the demand that's out there because of the increased availability that I have with distribution. I'm also exploiting the algorithms, not just sitting here waiting for them, of the online booksellers, because I have good and I have responsive metadata. So I'll take you back to the TikTok example. In late 2020, there were sales of a particular book that started skyrocketing because of some viral posts the author had. But I didn't have to worry about supply chain issues that others were having with POD, because I had a warehouse full of books. And with my distributor's help, I was able to prioritize shipments to certain stores and get more printed and shipped quickly. Now, at the same time, I was making fast changes to that book's metadata. And all of this is really about the snowball effect. You know, one thing happened, those viral posts that got the ball rolling, and then all the other systems that were in place helped to make sure it kept rolling and was getting bigger. So let's talk about increased sales. This is Central Avenue's sales over the last 7 years, and I've indicated where I've added tools. Now, aside from that dip in 2018-19, because I sold a major portion of my backlist to another publisher, our sales continued to increase above industry averages. Now, that bump in sales over the last 2 years has been in part because of viral posts and, you know, market conditions, but it's been because of other things too, like more and better acquisitions, moving from 12 new titles a year now to 18. And I think I have, you know, my fiction titles performing better because I have the time to initiate and carry out effective marketing campaigns. You know, but maybe the reason for the higher growth or the higher sales is because I'm just making better decisions, because I'm working up here now and I don't have to worry about being sued over incorrect royalty statements or taking hours in my garage to pack up books, or figuring out and maintaining 8 different spreadsheets and web forms. You know, there's an old saying that the internet tells me is accredited to the Roman poet Plautus: you must spend money to make money. It can be difficult, trust me, to make those investments, but I'm telling you, if you do, you're setting yourself up for future success. Okay, thank you for joining us today. And I think we have about 10 minutes or so for questions.
Thank you, Michelle. One question that came up actually while David Marlin was presenting was Francine and Kelly were both asking if you could identify the royalty management software you chose.
Ah, yeah. Well, it's MetaComet royalty tracker. So yeah, I met them at a trade show several years ago and I was like, why would I pay for royalty software? That's silly. I could do it myself. And so the conversations ensued. I don't know if David, if you want to mention anything about that.
Thank you, Michelle, for mentioning that. What we see is people that use our tools regularly save about 90% of effort just because of all the automation. You know, it's just, our objective is to get it so you just have to push a button when your royalties are due and they're just statements are distributed, payments are made and available. We keep trying to improve that and get it as automated as possible. So thank you for the plug, Michelle.
Kind of a related question. Edson was asking, and this is for you, Michelle, I think to start, how did you choose your partners that are, you know, the ones that you were talking about here? You know, is it word of mouth, industry events, RFIs or RFPs, advice from the community?
That's an awesome question. And it's one we've done this so many times and never been asked that. So, you know, I started my business in 2008. And when I realized who I wanted to be as a publisher, I realized I needed distribution. And so then began the search for a distributor. It happened that in 2015, I was going to Book Expo. And I'd been turned down for distribution so many times. And I thought, you know what, I'm just going to go and walk up to distributors that are at the show in their booths and see what happens. And, you know, when I came away from that show, I had offers from three or four public distributors, some of whom are not around anymore. I ended up with IPG. I'm sure glad I did. And the reason I ended up choosing them was because they could help me navigate the financials of moving to traditional distribution. Because when you move away from POD, there's a significant impact on your cash flow and your financials. You need at least 3 or 4 months to kind of balance out. And then I would say about a year of figuring out how this new model works for you, especially if you've been working in a POD environment until then. But they were the ones who came through and said, here, this is how you can help, you know, do a P&L, proper P&L, and work through some of these things that you're going to have to work through. Royalty Tracker came on, like I said, it was probably 4 years ago. I was at a trade show and I just walked around talking to some of the vendors and I ended up, you know, figuring that out. Metadata management was funny. I had nothing. I was that person that could do it all. I'm super smart. I can do this all myself. I'm not spending money where I don't have to. And when the four of us started talking about doing these types of seminars on publishing processes, Joshua was here, and of course I'd heard of NetGalley and that kind of thing, but I had no idea about metadata management. And I think we'd been working on these webinars about a year and a half, and I was finally convinced that I needed metadata management software. And so it was actually just through doing this that I ended up saying, "Yeah, I'm going to try that." So, and I'm really glad I did.
How about from the other panelists? How do you typically find your clients? I mean, do folks approach you directly? Is it arm's length, RFPs, et cetera?
I'll go first.
Sure.
So I think that that's always a famous question is, you know, how do you connect with a distributor and make the relationship work? And I think ultimately it really, there are going to be various services that you're going to need. I mean, Michelle, like she pointed out, was kind of already working within a print-on-demand model and needed to transition into traditional distribution. And we were experts on both sides. So we understand how to help a publisher make that closure and that gap. But I think it's a relationship business. And I think you have to meet people. And at that point, you'll know whether or not they're the right people to partner your business with. I mean, the services that we provide are one thing, but the relationships are also very important. And, you know, the one thing that the reason why we do these webinars is because we all work together. We all understand the relationship that we have and the way that works for our businesses. So I think that, you know, one of the main things I would say is if you're out there and you're looking to figure out which services are going to be best for you, actually meet the people. Try to just have a conversation, that because that's going to be not just a service that you're buying, but that's going to be a support team that you're going to need for maybe years to come, and you're going to need to know that they're on your side.
Wholeheartedly agree with that.
So yeah, if I could add to that, you know, publishers find us in all kinds of different ways. I think word of mouth is a huge one. You know, so just to echo what Richard said is talk to folks. You know, when it comes to RFPs and RFIs, I know a lot of larger companies are almost required to do that. And my advice there would be, you know, the RFPs and RFIs are really challenging. I can tell you from experience that very often vendors are selected before the process starts, and the RFP or RFI is to justify that decision. And so it puts a lot of stress and pressure on vendors because you kind of know that going in. I know that we've won RFIs that we were told in advance that we were going to win. And I know that we've lost our lives that we haven't been told that. I would say, but I do understand the importance and value of them to companies. I would say what I think, and I can't tell you how many times companies have issued an RFI of which we didn't get, and then they come back to us 2 years later and they end up working with us because it didn't work out. So I think the most, in my opinion, when it comes to royalties, to the royalty piece, if you're going to issue an RFP or an RFI, give the vendor a bunch of data that represents all your scenarios. Let them process it for you and show you the results, rather than, or in addition to asking them, you know, a huge 20-page questionnaire. Because those questionnaires, let's just be real. Everybody fudges. Everybody says they can do everything. Everybody says they can do things they can't. But make them prove it to you. You know, give them some of your data and just make them prove it to you. And then the gaps will be obvious. So that would be my recommendation if you're going to go the RFP, RFI route. I would say the best way to do it, though, from the royalty perspective is just, like Richard said, develop the relationship, meet the people, ask them for demos, and let them show it to you. Because putting together an RFI takes a ridiculous amount of work. You're asking, whether you realize it or not, you're asking a whole slew of vendors to spend 40, 80, 100 hours responding to it. And again, sometimes they're necessary, but I think if you can avoid it, it's oftentimes worth not going that route.
Okay. How about you, Joshua?
Yeah, I think I'll build on what Richard was saying. I think the relationship aspect of any kind of relationship you have with a vendor, I don't like that term even, because really, like from the Firebrand perspective, we are partners with publishers, right? We partner with publishers to help you do the work that you do by providing services and tools that help you do that. And so when it comes down to, you know, what's going to make the difference between one partner versus another partner, it's about what solutions are going to help you achieve the business success that you want. Now, I think, you know, we've been building, you know, Firebrand's been around 35 years, and we've been building those relationships in the industry for that entire time. And I think Fran, our CEO, has probably one of the most well-known people in publishing because of just that approach of saying, look, you know, here's what we can do, but our goal is to help you. Right? It's really about a partnership and helping you find solutions to the problems you have. And I think that's more important and a better approach than saying, let's look at vendors and decide between different vendors, because it's not always an apples to apples comparison. It's about that relationship and what you can do to build that partnership over the course of many years.
Michelle, I want to thank you for both sharing your story and helping to pull this event together. Joshua, Richard, David, it's always good to see you, and thank you for your contributions, not just to BISG, but to the industry as a whole. I really appreciate it. I'm sure we'll see and hear from you again soon, but in the meantime, thank you for this session, and we look forward to hearing back from the community about what they've learned as a result.
Thank you.
Thank you so
everybody.
Much.
Thank you. Really.